Good evening. Merry Christmas Eve.
Merry Christmas Eve.
Praise be to the name of Jesus. God is so good. Let's go before the Lord.
Amen.
Father God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for your grace. We thank you, Father God, for your love. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Today is the night before you were born. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for being born. Thank you, Father, for sending us a son to deliver us from all of our troubles. Thank you, and redeeming us back to you, giving us the ministry of reconciliation because you reconcile us to you first. We thank you. No other God but you. Father God, we thank you that you've given us this perfect gift, and his name is Jesus. And we thank you, Jesus, because you have had more than just one birthday. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now, Father God, as we take this new adventure to your word, we believe, Father God, that you are going to show us these intricate details of your word so that we can grab hold of these things and we will be the better for it. The better. The better. We love you and we appreciate you. Open up our hearts. Open up our understanding. We bind any hindering spirit that will come against these services. Open up our minds so that we can receive, Lord Jesus. Now I submit myself to you, Father God, spirit, soul, and body. Use my mind, use my heart, use my mouthpiece to minister your word to your people this night. And we covenant with you right now, Father God, to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for every victory that will come out of today's session. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Hey, no, we're not doing that. We have been studying over the last few weeks from time to time services. And for the last couple of years, we've been studying on celebrating the man, Jesus. Now celebrating the man, not just the baby. Celebrating the man. And rightfully so, every year right around this time, a lot of us preachers and a lot of people, we tend to get focused in on the baby. and you see it all the time. But in a lot of them, and it's kind of funny how the world, when they're putting out their movies, even in Christian television, they show the birth of Jesus. I mean, I promise I get it. They show the birth of Jesus, and then they show out the rest of the life of Jesus. But a lot of us, after Jesus ascends and gone back on to heaven, I really would love to see, and maybe it's our calling to do it here, but if somebody's hearing me out there, I don't think it's my calling to make a movie, but if somebody hears this and it's your calling to make a movie, please make the movie about the 40 days that Jesus actually lived on the earth before his ascension. I would love to see that. I would love to see that. And maybe, I mean, I believe that's come straight from the Spirit of God, the throne. Because a lot of us, you know, I'm 42 years old. I'm knocking at the door of 43. And ever since I can remember, I was yay, yay, high. I've always seen King of Kings. I've always seen Jesus Nazareth. I've always seen The Greatest Story Ever Told. And those are the three big movies. Now you got these other movies coming out, and they call them Jesus. A few years ago, we had The Passion of the Christ. But The Passion of the Christ, it mostly focused in on the last few days. And it has some reminiscing moments within the movie about Jesus when he talks to the disciples. But it mostly focused on the last few days with Jesus on the earth and after his crucifixion. And then it showed Jesus raised from the dead. And then that was it. But you got these other movies, they pretty much do the same thing. Jesus born, And then they show the life of Jesus, and Jesus died, he rose from the dead, and then he went right on back to heaven. Do a movie about those 40 days. Those 40 days where he actually appeared to his disciples. Then that's going to be some stuff. Take the time, because Jesus, 40 days, in God's eyesight, it's a twinkle. But to us, a month and 10 days, 30 days, 10 more days after that, it's some things going on. Some things had to happen. Where, we see Jesus, we get so focused just in on the baby, we forget that this baby grew up. Mm-hmm. And that's what we've been studying on. So, I would like for you all to turn your Bibles to the book of Luke. We've already talked about Jesus and his birth. Last year, we got focused in on Zacharias. You go back and do look stuff up. We focused on Zacharias as John the Baptist's father. And how he proclaimed John the Baptist to be the forerunner of Jesus. And then we also got focused on a few other things. Mary Magdalene. Mary, Jesus' mama, and Joseph, being the stepfather, being the surrogate father. He wasn't a stepfather, because a stepfather is when they actually step in and become a father of a child, where the dad is not actually taking care of the child. So Joseph was more of a surrogate father. God was there. God has taken care of Jesus since day one. Always has and always will. But we learned about how the angel showed up. I think we hit on some key points. We hit on some key points, because the word talks about him. How Jesus, even though he was born in a manger, he wasn't broke. Mm-hmm. I know we hit on that. This last couple of weeks, we showed this Jesus walking around, had a house. Yeah, some of y'all looking at me now, some of y'all ain't even need to know that. Jesus had a house. I was listening to a man of God just the other day, and he was like, think about Jesus when he rode a donkey. If people are so funny and they so religious minded, they think, let me ask you a question. Do you walk everywhere you go? I know I have a truck. It's old, paid for, it runs, but I don't walk anywhere I go. I might walk around my job and do walk around store and stuff like that. But when I'm going from one destination to the next, I drive. I drive. Some people, they think, they get this idea in their head that Jesus just, he walked everywhere he went. And I know that can't be true. Go from Jesus had, when he was born in Nazareth, and then after they tried to kill him in his own hometown, the Bible tells us that he packed up, picked up his mama, we believe it so, and then he ended up moving to Capernaum. Think about it. He had a real physical move. How many of y'all ever moved before? A bunch of hands out there. When you pack stuff up, move. Men do that. I know our kids, we've moved. They can do a little stuff, they do a little thing, but when they're real little, they don't do a whole lot of moving stuff. So when Jesus was a baby, here come Joseph and Mary, they had to move Jesus around. Mm-hmm. And this is where we're gonna pick part of this story up here in Luke chapter 2. I got the King James Version here, but I'm gonna be reading out of the Good News Version. And we're going to see this grown man. We're going to see this Jesus. We're going to see this Jesus when he was younger. And then he start to develop into the man that we know of as Messiah. Uh-oh. It hit right on the head. See, some of y'all's mind still going back to this little bitty old baby. So we got to go look at the development. The Bible teaches and talks about the development of Jesus himself, how he grew up. Look what it says. Luke chapter 2. And look at verse 3. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. Okay, keep her right there, Look what it says. Joseph was what? He was in the house and lineage of David. He was in the house of the lineage of David. He had to go to, where it said it? If you go back up, he had to go to, his own hometown, his own hometown, so that he can give an account, pay taxes, register. There was a big mass registry. It goes on nowadays, every year, census. Thank you very much for that. It's still registered. Yeah. Trying to preach my sermon. Here you go. He had to go and register. Well, Joseph did that. It said Joseph was part of the household and lineage of King David. Household and lineage of King David. Now, as you know as well as I do, I got cousins whom I've never even met before. I mean, literally, I had a family member send me a friend request on Facebook today. And I'm like, ain't this person my cousin? I had to ask my mama, is this person my cousin? Well, nah, yes, and no, and yeah, and no, and not really, but we see them as our cousins. So they like the third and fourth string cousin way down, right down the road. So there's nothing wrong with that. I got family members that I've never even seen. They've never even seen me, but I know that they're there. Here Joseph is, he had to go register because he was somewhat of a distant cousin or relative that was in the bloodline of King David. I want y'all to really, really catch that. That's very key. Watch why this is very key. Verse 5. He says, he went to register with Mary, who was promised in marriage to him. She was pregnant. Verse 6. And while they were in Bethlehem, the time came for her to have her baby. She gave birth to her first son, wrapped. I love this right here in the Good News Version. Notice it said her first son. She gave birth to her first son, wrapped him in strips of cloth, and that swaddling clothes, as King James says, laid him in a manger because there was no room to stay for them in the inn. Stop right there. No room for them to stay in the hotel. Hotels were packed. Why? Because there was a great census that was going on, and a massive influx of people showed up into the little bitty old town called Bethlehem. And there was no room for them to sleep in the inn. Question, how is it that preachers, they've read that, but they don't stop to actually talk about it? How many of you all ever showed up someplace, go someplace, and all of a sudden you go to a hotel and there's no reservation? There's no room in the hotels. I know, right? I can remember one time, years ago, we showed up at a hotel. We had reservations, and them jokers gave our room away. And I'm thinking in my head like, no, I got a reservation, so they had to end up bumping us up and giving us a bigger room at the lower price. Yes, praise God. praise God. Mm-hmm. That's very, very key. Here Jesus is. She gave birth to this baby. We know as who? Our Lord. Look what it says. I want you to drop down. Drop down all the way down for you. You said went out a whole bunch of verses. It says, verse 17. When the shepherds saw him, they told them what the angel had said about the child. All who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said, Mary remembered all these things and thought deeply about them. The shepherds went back singing praises to God for all they had heard and seen. It had been just as the angel had told them. Verse 20 in the King James, it says like this. And the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. Now, stop right here. Shepherd boys at the birth of Jesus Christ. The birth. Look what it says. Verse 21. I want y'all to read it. Let's just look at the top verse. What did it say? And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Stop right there. Look what it says. What it say? 8 days later. 8 days later. So now here Jesus is. He went from being a 1 hour old baby to an 8 day old baby. That's not too much difference from the baby, right? But what is it showing us? It's showing us what? Growth.
Yeah.
It's showing us growth. Now, ain't too much different from a day old baby, an hour old baby, to an 8 day old baby. It's still an infant. Yeah, that's the part you need to see that. But it's showing us a pattern. And the book of Luke is teaching us this pattern. Look what it said in the Good News Version. It says like this. About a week later, when the time came for the baby to be circumcised, his name was called Jesus. The name which the angel had given him before he had been conceived. Look what it did right here. Verse 22. The time came for Joseph and Mary to perform the ceremony of purification as the law of Moses commanded. So they took the child to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. What does it say in verse 22? What does it say in verse 22? What does it say in verse 22? And when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, the days of her what? If you go look up under the book of Leviticus, it tells you the time about a woman after she gives birth to a baby. It tells us that 21 more days had to go by. Even in today's time, when a woman gives birth to a baby, the doctor says, and some of y'all please hear me slowly, we're gonna talk about this. I don't want your children to hear this. Some of y'all may know this. It says that a woman should wait at least 6 weeks before she have intercourse with her husband. 6 weeks. Up under the Old Testament, it was at least 21 days. You go read that through the book of Leviticus. That is key. Why is it talking about that? Why is it talking about that? It's still showing us this progression of growth. Now here Jesus is from a 1 day old baby to a month old baby. Watch this. Well, look what it says. Drop down. Look what it says. All the way down to verse, verse 33. The child's father and mother were amazed at the things Simeon had said about him. Now, if you go back and read it, because I want you to take time for a second time, I'm just going to tell you. But go back and read it yourself so you can pick up on some key things. Joseph and Mary went to the temple, and Simeon, one of the preachers in the temple, God had told him that the Lord, the baby, come in and see him, come in unto him, and he will see the baby with his own eyes. Yeah. I'm assuming that somewhere before that, he knew the time was going to come, and that he had to, he said, Father or God, however he wanted to call him, he probably said, God, I want to see the birth of this baby. I've been faithful to you, and so as a favor to me, I want to see the birth of this baby. I want to see this baby come to mind, and God will just answer one of his prayers. I mean, it's not far-fetched. We get prayers answered all the time. Don't you all ask God to save your children? And then, you know, God will tell you he gonna save your children, and then all of a sudden the child go back out in the street and act like a complete nut. But you stay on God's promise. God, you gonna save my child. It may take 22 years, but and I know that I went down that path of the road. My mama laid on the floor crying out to the Lord. Now, he belonged to you. You said it. I'm trusting you, Lord. And then I gave my life to Christ at 16. But by the time I was 18, I was back out in the street. And all of a sudden, 28 years later, 26 years old, I gave my life back over to the Lord, rededicated my life. And now here I am. That's an answered prayer to my mom. Why is that so hard-fetched to believe that maybe Simeon believed? Notice what he said. The child's father and mother were amazed at the things Simeon said about him. Simeon said some cool things. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, this child, look what he's saying. Look what this child is doing now. It's a child. It's at least a month old baby. This child is chosen by God for the destruction and the salvation of many in Israel. Why would he say destruction? Why would he say destruction? Why would he say destruction? Satan had such a solid grip on everybody because of the Old Testament's laws and rules and regulations. Nobody could keep them. Nobody could. At this time, every man, woman, boy, and girl, Satan thought that he had a compelling argument with God to get everybody to go to hell. And Jesus came for the destruction of Satan's grip that was on mankind. Oh, Lord Jesus, that just hit me. It's like right over here. And Jesus came and completely destroyed that grip. Completely destroyed that grip. And he pronouncing this over a baby. Drop down. Look at verse 39. No, let's read verse 38 first. That very same hour, she arrived and gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were waiting for God to set Jerusalem free. Verse 39, when Joseph and Mary had finished doing all that was required by the law of the Lord, based on the book of Leviticus, Jesus was just born. Jesus had to go through the 8 days of purification as far as the baby is concerned, and then they named the baby, then 21 more days had to go by for Mary to be purified. They gave the census, they paid their taxes, they did everything that was required. Look what it says. They returned to their hometown in Nazareth, Galilee. Watch what it says, verse 40. The child grew, Jesus grew up. I thought he stayed a little bit young baby. The child grew and became strong. He was what? Full of wisdom, and God's blessings were upon him. Look, see that? The Bible even says that Jesus grew up. But yet at the same time, religion and the world, they keep pushing this baby Jesus in front of us, making it seem as if that Jesus never went to the cross. And this is one of the main reasons why people live today as if that Jesus never went to the cross, because they keep having this image of Jesus as a baby. I'm gonna let y'all let that sink in. The grips that Satan had on us has been broken. Please get that. Look what it says. Verse 41. Every year, the parents of Jesus went to Jerusalem. Why did the Bible? Oh, I gotta back up. Let me go read that again. Verse 41. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year. Hold on, every year. Stop. Every year. So every year, right around Jesus' birthday, they had to go to a census. They had to go to what do they call them again? I said a census already. They had to go register. Every year, right around Jesus' birthday time, every year they had to go pay taxes. Stop. Why is the Bible signifying this every year? Even over here in the Good King and the Good News Version, it still says every year. Every year, the parents of Jesus went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was about 12 years old, when Jesus was about what?
12.
So 12 years old. 12. Wouldn't that tell you that Jesus had at least 11 other birthdays?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right. So, and I've said it before, it seems as if that most people forget about Jesus having more than one birthday. And every year around Christmas time, they put this baby up in our face. And the only person, please hear me, I am so glad Jesus was born. And thank you, but I'm this new age believer. I want to talk to this man. Babies can't tell me too much. Babies don't know how to deliver me from any kind of iniquity. Jesus already forgave me and delivered me from it, but for some reason, this thing still has a grip on me, and I don't know how to get rid of it. He's already broken the yokes and the bondages on my life, but yet at the same time, I keep having this baby, and if a baby come up to you and tell you right now, I am here to help deliver you from your yokes and bondages. Oh boy, you can't tell me nothing. You too. Get away from me. Watch what it says. Look what it says. When Jesus was 12 years old, they went to the festival as usual. When the festival was over, they started back home, but the boy Jesus stayed in Jerusalem. His parents did not know this. They thought that he was with the group, with a whole lot of people. So every year, right around Jesus' birthday, they went to Bethlehem and to register to the festival and to register and everything else. And they thought Jesus was just with his cup. They thought, ain't Jesus with John the Baptist? He might be with Elizabeth and Zacharias. He might be. So it's okay.
Yeah.
He hanging out with John.
Yeah.
Look what it says. His parents did not know this. They thought he was with the group. So they traveled a whole day and then started looking for him among their relatives and friends. They did not find him. So they went back to Jerusalem looking for him. Man, I would have been a little nervous. Maybe a little scared. But I would have been, me as a father, I'd be looking for my boy, get over here! I don't know about, see, some of y'all too religious for me, man. Get over here! And then you want to hug them, and hug them, and then you want to smack them too. Don't you, no, you stay with me! Praise God. They did not find him, so they went back to Jerusalem looking for him. On the third day, they found him in the temple, sitting with the Jewish teachers, listening to them and asking questions. Here Jesus is, sitting with a bunch of grown folk. He was preaching the other day. Yeah. Jesus, I know he a man of God, and I understand that, but Jesus, you supposed to be with us. How many of y'all would have did that? Look what it says. All who heard him were amazed at his intelligent answers. And Jesus is teaching too.
Yeah.
They asked Jesus a question, and Jesus answered them back intelligently. Can't no baby do that. It's even hard to get a 12-year-old kid to do that. But look what's going on. All who were amazed. His parents were astonished when they saw him. And his mother said to him, My son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been terribly worried trying to find you. He answered, why did you have to look for me? Bap! I'm sorry. That would be me. Why you got to look for me? Boy, you're 12 years old! You ain't ready to do nothing. That's what my wife would tell me. Since I would slap Jesus. My wife told me when we were rereading that, I would slap him. As a mama, you would slap him. But look what happened. Mary didn't do that, though.
No.
Why are you looking at me? Did you not know I'll be in my father's house? But they did not understand his sayings. So Jesus went back with them to Nazareth, where he was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. Jesus grew both in body and in wisdom, gaining favor in God and man, or the people. He did what? He grew in favor and what? What does the Bible say? In what? In wisdom.
Wisdom. Statue.
He grew. So now, if you look over in Luke chapter 3, the very next verse in Luke chapter 3, look what it says. Now in the fifth year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, governor of Judea, and Herod being the tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of what's the place name? Yeah, that word. Andrea, and the region of Trachonitis and Lysanias, the tetrarch of Albania, come. Ananias and Caiaphas being the high priest, the word of God came unto John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. Hold on. The very next verse, you start reading how it's a whole nother king that's in charge of everything. But then you read what? About Zacharias. Look what it said in verse 3. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. So who is this?
John.
This is now John the Baptist. The Bible fast forwards 12, from Jesus being 12 years old, all the way to John the Baptist being grown. Mm-hmm. Preaching and teaching. Now, if you go back and read through those scriptures, you'll see where John the Baptist and Jesus are about 6 months apart. Because you'll see where Mary, she went to her cousin's house. And Mary was, what's that lady's name? Elizabeth was, she was about 6 months pregnant while Jesus was already in the oven cooking. He had just started being cooking. Okay? 6 months apart. So John the Baptist is 6 months older than Jesus. Why did the Bible fast forward that many years? The Bible has already given us enough information about the birth of John the Baptist and Jesus. It didn't have to go tell us about Jesus when he was 15 years old. It didn't have to really go tell us about Jesus when he was 20 years old. It told us right in that last verse. Look what it said in verse 51. So Jesus went back with them to Nazareth, where he was obedient unto them. His mother treasured all the things in her heart. Jesus grew both in body and wisdom, gaining favor with God and the people. And man. What'd he do? He grew. What'd he do? He grew. So now here you, we catch Jesus over a period of, and the Bible tells us that Jesus, when he was in chapter 4, it tells us that Jesus, when he was about 30 years old, he stepped off into his ministry. He stepped off into his ministry. Go back up there and read at the end. Yeah, John, Luke chapter 4. Look what it says. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of him. Now, what book was that in, Lord? Let me go back and read. Because I don't want to mess y'all up and give y'all false information. Matthew chapter 4 and chapter 3 and chapter 4. You catch a glimpse of Jesus from a young baby all the way up to when Jesus was full grown. Where is it at? Yeah, there, right there. Matthew chapter 3 and Matthew and in the beginning of Matthew chapter 4. So y'all got it. So and that's why I picked that up, because you won't find it in Mark. You won't find it in Luke chapter 3. You won't find it in Luke, but when you cover the scripture chapters together, you pick that up. And also, if I remember right, it's also in the book of Luke. I mean, book of Mark. Go over to the book of Mark real quickly. We got a few more minutes. Go to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 1. Where is that? Holy Spirit, come show it to me. Mark chapter 1. I want to make sure y'all get all the scriptures together, because as you compile them together, you get a real sense of how Jesus is growing up. Where is that? Yeah, Mark chapter 1 and verse 13 all the way to verse 20. All the way to verse 20. You get this. You get the complete census. Had to do some studying on that one. So, where we leave off at? Over in the book of Luke. Over in the book of Luke, chapter 3. Into chapter 3 and chapter 1 into chapter 4. You get this whole census now that Jesus has grown up now. He's a full grown man. Question. How many birthdays went by that the Bible don't even talk about? Quite a few of them, am I correct? Quite a few of them. From 13 all the way to Jesus when he was 30.
Yeah.
So you're talking about what?
Oh, yeah.
Another how many years? Another 17 years Jesus had at least 17 years more birthdays. Question. The Bible Bible doesn't even talk about Jesus' birthdays anymore. The Bible don't. But we know he had them. Don't you all still have birthdays as you get older? And how many of you all remember, I mean, like me, I can remember when my children were born, I can remember that, but they can't. And like my mom will come to me, my mother remembers my birthdays, but like I said, I don't remember them. And my mama don't come to me like, boy, I remember the day when you were born. Yeah, she don't look at my face like that. She just sees me as a full grown man now. Hey, look what it says. Look what it said. Chapter 4. Cause we almost through here. Look what it said, chapter 4. Verse 6. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. If thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. Why am I taking you this part right here? This was one of the last intricate temptations that Satan could tempt Jesus with. Remember it says over in the book of Timothy that there are three main temptations, there are three main temptations: the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Every sin that you can possibly think of, it will be categorized up under one of the big three. So a lot of y'all think it's so many different sins. What about the sin of smoking? What about the smoking? Really ain't a sin. Smoking will get you to heaven faster. But it ain't necessarily a sin. Okay? But every sin that you can possibly think of is categorized up under one of them three sins. And this last one that Satan tempted Jesus with was the pride of life. Notice that again. He said, if thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. He tried to offer Jesus complete power over everything. All he had to do was acknowledge that Satan was God of all. Jesus said that there is no other God but God. Jesus bowed down to the Father. He bowed down. He showed us that we bow down to the Father. Look how Jesus responded. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him shalt thou serve. Why do you think the Bible says that? So, why do you think Jesus said it's so intricate? Why do you think the Bible said it's so intricate? Think about it. What did the Bible we just read over the last 40 minutes? We read that Jesus what? Grew in wisdom and stature and favor with man and God. God and man. He grew. A baby, if you was to go to a baby or even just a child and tempt a child with a bunch of stuff, that child won't go for the stuff. No man who has acknowledged that God is God and he's committed himself to God is going to worship any stuff. Glory to God, man. Glory to God. So now we've picked up how Jesus is totally, totally surrendering himself over to the Father. Last verse, verse 9. And when he brought him to Jerusalem, he set him on the pinnacle of the temple. He tried it one more time. and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. For it is written, he misquoted the Bible. What Jesus said in verse 12? And Jesus answered and said unto him, It is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Why do you think Jesus said that? A lot of us, we make this dumb statement. God tempted me, tested me to see if I'm going to drink this poison. God tempted me to see if I'm going to go have sex with this woman. That ain't God. He said, don't tempt me. He said, I'll protect you. But you go messing around with the curse that I've delivered you from, that curse will hurt you. That curse will hurt you. The curse is out there. Jesus came and broke that yoke, broke that destruction. He broke it from us. We don't have to submit to it. It's broken from us. Did I say last verse? I lied. Go over to Romans. Yeah, this will be the last verse. This will be the last verse. Shoot. But this is good, man. Look what it said. Look what it says. Romans chapter 5. Mm-hmm. It says this. Verse 19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many what? Be made righteous. No baby could have performed that. Only a full-grown man who knew that God was the deliverer of all. And Jesus was that man. A full-grown man. A full-grown man. That's powerful, people. That is so powerful. As we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, honor the man. Honor the man. He delivered us from the bondages and yokes of everything that Satan could ever put in front of us. And that man, we know him as Jesus. So, hey, I wish all of you all out there a Merry Christmas. And I believe when you start honoring the man, you'll begin to see yokes and bondages just break off. Because Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. Remember, continue to learn how to follow Jesus Christ faithfully, holy, and holy. Merry Christmas to you guys out there.